Welcome to the first part in a six-part look at Bonekickers. So what is Bonekickers and why should you care? Well, it's many things, but mostly it's the show that dared to look at Torchwood at its dumbest and say, I could be stupider. Basically, it's a cross between Torchwood and Time Team, minus any random bisexuality and missing a semblance of self-respect. It's the stupidest show broadcast in the UK in the last 10 years, and those 10 years have included a show that features time travel by way of head injury, and a show that said if you own a Richard Dawkins book, then you're possessed by the devil. It's also been created by Matthew Graham, who wrote Fear Her, thus cementing him in Hagen's list of people who she wouldn't let the minions piss on if they were on fire. This show is what happens when the mind that gave the world a spaceship powered by love attempts to bring his talents to the world of archaeology. To give you an idea of how bad the show is, it was made by the BBC, but the DVD was released by ITV. BBC and ITV are the two biggest hitters in UK television. The BBC were so sure that the show would be as big a flop on DVD as it was on TV that they gave it to their biggest rival to release. And they were right. I picked up my copy of the full series for £1.59, and the show was less than 3 years old. It concentrates on a team of archaeologists who operate out of that well-known hotbed of intrigue, Bath. Somehow, week after week, they end up taking part in implausible adventures, find and often destroy world-changing artifacts, and sometimes end up killing people. And for all this, they are somehow not A. famous, or B. in jail. The team is led by Dr. Elizabeth Magwild, the least fortunately named doctor since that prickin' memory run. She's played by Julie Graham, who seems to have based her entire style of acting on what she thinks will look cool in the trailer.
Well, we have a medieval riddle to solve. So we start digging.
She's assisted by Adrian Lester as Dr. Ben Erga, who as far as I can tell is an automaton who can't quite replicate human emotion and is powered by a black hole that feeds on the ability to act. Hugh Bonneville plays Professor Gregory Parton, nicknamed Dolly. It is a real shame when your most sanely named main character is a man called Dolly Parton. The writers seem to have decided that chauvinism was a decent substitute for character. He's supposed to be charming and roguish, but comes across as an alcoholic potential rapist.
I'll just put the kettle on.
About his drinking, I'm unsure if it was written that way or if Hugh Bonneville just decided he needed to get smashed in order to get through one of the scripts. Gugu Mbatha-Ra, whose name I am mangling and I am sorry, plays Viv Davis, who doesn't get a fancy title because she's just finished at university. Her character's a weird cross between an old-school Doctor Who companion, there to make insanely dumb mistakes and be the access point for the very stupidest members of the audience, but at the same time be the Wesley Crusher, the young genius who sees things that the older ones can't, or won't. It's as though the character has two personalities, both of whom are exactly the same except one has an IQ of 70 and the other has an IQ of 150. So anyway, this is Bonekickers. You have been warned. Episode 1, Army of God, opens in 1307 in Bath, England. Bath is apparently a forest, even though Bath was founded by the Romans and has been constantly inhabited since then. Knights are having a fight and one of the knights dies, and then we're 700 odd years later and some construction workers have found the knight's body, with a Middle Eastern coin, so the main cast turn up to solve this mystery. Now, there's a few problems with this whole setup. Okay, so the knight died in the forest and the city spread over him, but the forest can't have been anywhere near the already biggish city of Bath because he has been found complete with his armour and sword. If his body was anywhere near the city, someone would have found it and probably stolen the very expensive armour he was wearing in the decades before his body was covered by Mother Nature. But at the same time, the city needs to be close enough to have spread out over the next 700 years and cover his resting place. And on top of that, do they expect us to believe that the site hasn't ever been built on? In the last 700 years, some of which time has been in the middle of the city, no one has ever dug this place up. Not once. Yes, they do expect us to believe this. Now, enough of the stupidity of the situation, and onto the stupidity of the characters. The main cast claim it's a massive mystery why a knight that they identify as a crusader would have Middle Eastern coins found with him. The guy had been on a crusade. He brought some coins back with him. It's called international travel, and it's not new. Hey assholes, Occam wants you to stop sodomizing him with his razor! And just so you know, we're 2 minutes in, 58 to go. Viv Davis turns up, the Doctor Who companion personality in charge, and immediately stands on the edge of the trench, damaging it. Ben yells at her to either get into the trench or stay in the wood. Seriously, her making a mistake like that is like me, someone with a BSc in film production technology, not realizing what end of a camera you're supposed to aim at someone to film them.
Professor Gregory Parton. Think of him as Google with a beer gut.
Call me Dolly.
Well, hello, Dolly.
Nice smile, inspirational chest.
How the hell has this man avoided sexual harassment suits? Those are his first words to a woman 20 years his junior. I can only assume that either I'm extremely misled about the strength of British sexual harassment laws, or that Professor Parton is so damn good at his job that his employers have the ready cash to pay off every woman he harasses. Now, only 2 minutes after Viv got in trouble for standing on the edge of a trench, something that's so stupid that no one who graduated in archaeology from university would ever do it, Dr. Magwild perches herself on the edge of the trench and begins to talk to it!
Come on. Give up your secrets.
She then stands and starts hearing the sound of battle in her head. In a sane world, in a world where people work out the obvious, a world where sexual harassment gets you in trouble, in a world that has not been created by Matthew Graham, Dr. Magwild would have been locked up a long time ago. There's a word for people who talk to a hole in the ground and hear battles inside their head, and it's not doctor. Viv's second personality takes over, and within minutes she manages to find the bodies of the other warriors, something which the older, more experienced archaeologists hadn't managed to do in the hours they've been working at it. How do I know they've been working for hours? Well, apart from the effing huge trench they've managed to dig, Professor Parton mentions that he's just brought everyone lunch. So they dig up a second trench and...
Symbolism! Symbolism!
So they now reveal that the people who butchered the knights were in fact Saracens, who got to England, 2,000 miles from the Middle East, during the Crusades, in order to kill some knights, and were never noticed by anyone, even though they killed the knights near a city.
It appears to be a skirmish between professional soldiers and Turks. Here in the heart of England.
2,000 miles away from the Crusades.
This is rewriting the book stuff.
Yes, every book ever. This rewrites reality. You might as well have had some time-travelling samurai fighting those knights, because it makes as much sense.
I can help, Vivian, pretty young intern person. When I'm impressed with you, I will ask for your help.
The same Dr. Magwild that had earlier employed the perch on the edge of the hole and try to talk it into giving up its secrets method of archaeology. Viv managed to find the rest of the bodies that everyone else had missed by using science.
You okay?
How am I going to impress her?
My guess would be start hearing things and talk to holes.
You'll think of something. We all had to.
He chatted to an abyss and Parton became pen pals with a trapdoor. So the three main cast members with titles go to a late night event where the bizarrely named Daniel Mastiff, the head of their archaeological department, is having a book launch. Daniel is basically every idiotic, effete British stereotype that you could expect to find in a hack Hollywood movie. Except this is a British show. So this is the rough equivalent of Spike Lee making a film that features minstrels. Which of course he did. Mastiff turns up in each episode and basically does this.
Oh hello, I'm British and although I may sound it, I am not gay. I love the ladies so very much. Ha ha! And I'm going to warn you not to get into any zany adventures, oh main cast, but you'll ignore me, and I won't do anything because I'm ineffectual and British. God save the Queen! Did I mention I'm British?
Back at the dig site, Viv's stupid personality is in charge, and she gets a nurse who dropped by to help her dig out some wood. In a way that in real life would most likely destroy the 700-year-old wood that spent centuries in mud. The nurse gets an extremely dramatic splinter.
It's just a splinter.
The two doctors and the professor come back to the site where they do their sub-CSI magic stuff involving ultraviolet lights, and they discuss the fact that the pieces of sword they found came from a scimitar. They decide that it's insane and impossible that knights would be fighting Middle Easterners in Bath in 1307 because, well, it is, even though just minutes ago they were talking about how their find of knights fighting Middle Easterners in Bath in 1307 would rewrite the history books.
This is rewriting the book stuff.
Series, you can't just suddenly decide that your earlier insane bullshit was bullshit and insane just as soon as you get evidence that it actually happened in the context of your story. That's not how this works! They work out that the knights were Templars because, well, they're the only knights that most people have heard of from that period. They go on to give Viv a short lecture on the Templars because, well, with them being ancient history and her being a university graduate with a degree in ancient history, she'd likely have never heard of them before. And then we're here. The dark room and the Dutch tilt immediately tell us that this is a villain's lair. The two guys talk only so the audience can see that they think they're modern-day Templar knights and they work for this prick, Slimy McSlimyhead. Slimy McSlimyhead sits in his villain chair in his villain room and calls Dr. Magwild on his villain phone to discuss the Templars and prayer and then hangs up because he's villainous.
Hallelujah, it worked.
The next day, Professor Parton shows off a cross that a pert third year found, making 3 references to the breasts of woman at least 20 years his junior in 15 minutes of screen time. It'd be impressive if it wasn't so ridiculous. They then recount the events that they've worked out.
And they're attacked by Saracens.
Which is patently absurd.
I really wish the characters wouldn't do my job for me. Yes, it's absurd. I've been saying that since the beginning of the episode. All of you lot just jumped on my bandwagon. Magwild suggests that the Templars might have had a precious cargo with them when they were attacked.
The only thing precious to the Knights Templar were spiritual relics from the Holy Land.
Yeah, you're a chauvinistic moron. The Templars were very rich and were wiped out because the King of France wanted to seize their wealth. Back with the villains, Slimy McSlimyhead is appearing on his frankly embarrassing-looking Christian fundamentalist show. The character's real name is Edward Legas, and he seems to have been created by someone who has no idea what the UK is actually like, which is impressive considering this is a British show. He's a TV personality, important political leader, and batshit insane fundamentalist Christian, a bit like Pat Robertson. But this isn't set in America, it's set in the UK. Not to say we don't have people like him in the UK, in fact he seems to be based on 2 people in particular. George Hargreaves runs the English Christian Party, the Scottish Christian Party, the Welsh Christian Party, and oh yes, the Christian Party, a man who has been known to get votes in double digits sometimes, and runs his parties mainly from the money he made writing pop songs back in the 80s. Songs like this. He's got a hand, big blue eyes, be able to satisfy. He's gotta be big and strong, enough to turn me on. He stands for making homosexuality illegal, but given the amount of gay club hits he wrote, I suspect he just wants to get all the gay people together in one place for a massive rave. He also wants to make it illegal to sell stuff on Sunday and wants to remove the dragon from the Welsh flag. The other person that Legas may have been based on is Nick Griffin, head of the British National Party, a fascist party with a limited following who are Christian in the sense that most European fascists are. They're using what they see as their country's religious identity as a way to get votes. Neither of these people have managed to get any seats in Parliament. Hargreaves' multiple parties rarely scrape triple-digit votes. They're both powerless jokes. They're only invited on TV so that interviewers can yell at them, or the general public can laugh at them. Legas is an insane creation because in the UK today, a figure like him would get exactly nowhere. Except perhaps Northern Ireland, but that's a rant for another day. Fucking Northern Ireland. So yeah, Legas is being threatening and stupid, and a Gap model playing a modern Templar wannabe is watching his TV show. And looking at his face, I think he's masturbating. So back in the CSI room, Magwild and Viv have a straw atheist versus hippy-dippy believer conversation that goes exactly nowhere. Adrian Lester attempts to smile before giving up and explaining about the wood that was found. Somehow, in the last hour, he's worked out that it's cedar, and from the pattern of rings, he's worked out that it's from 32 AD. Exactly.
Pattern of rings puts it at 32 AD.
Now I know very little about magical archaeological technology, but I cannot for the life of me work out how the fuck you use rings on wood to work out what year a tree was cut down in.
A piece of 2,000-year-old wood from the Holy Land.
Carried by the Knights Templar, who we know were entrusted with Christian relics from Jerusalem. Evidence that 2,000 years ago, someone may have been lacerated with a metal nail and bled into this wood.
Well, isn't that fantastic? It proves nothing more than there were people in the Holy Land in 32 AD, some of whom were crucified and bled on wood, which we already knew. And even if it was Jesus, then so what? It's not a big deal. There's a lot of secular historical evidence for the existence of Muhammad, Guru Nanak, Joseph Smith, and a lot of other founders of religions, and they don't get this fucking ooh special and spiritual music. Legas does another episode of his Standing in Front of the Sky show, bitching about spiritual aliens, while ignoring the irony of him championing a religion that came from 2,000 miles away over the worship of native British gods like Belinus and Tutatis. If you're gonna be a religious nationalist, be a fucking religious nationalist. Worship the Celtic gods. So the nurse who got the dramatic splinter has suddenly developed the ability to heal people with her touch. Because of reasons. And she tells the world that she got it when she helped a student archaeologist pull wood out of the ground. The three characters with titles automatically work out that she was talking about Viv, even though Viv's not a student, but a graduate, and they have multiple actual students working with them. Of course, since those actual students don't even get lines in this show, so they can't assume it was one of them. But still, there's no logical reason for them to assume it was Viv and for them to be right about the assumption. On their way back to the dig, they push their way through a crowd of reporters who think they found the true cross. Magwald mocks them by telling them they're going to find the Holy Grail in Atlantis next. At least it would have been a mock if by the end of the series they hadn't found Excalibur. So the two wannabe Templars, who really look like their day jobs are being male models, get their cross t-shirts and broadswords and wait in a mosque for Muslims they can threaten. Apart from the obvious question of how the fuck did they get into the mosque with no one noticing, you have to wonder how they smuggled the broadswords around. Yeah, they're wearing trench coats, but they're fucking broadswords! You so much as bend your knee and it looks like you have a third leg! So they have their conversation with Muslims about a holy war and threaten them with their swords.
Islam is a peaceful religion.
Frankly, it's not, but right now I'm aimed at the Christians. These two tossers are threatening Muslims with swords and talking about holy war. Members of the religion they're threatening have been talking about holy war for a long time, and they don't run around looking like gay pride punisher armed with swords. They blow you the fuck up! Of course, the sane Muslim can't talk the Templars down, and they're dedicated to setting off the war and then bringing their swords to what will be a gun and bigger gun fight. And in case you're wondering, no one calls the cops. So Magwild gives Viv the keys to her flat and tells her to bring some clothing on the radiator, for some reason, and she carefully tells her not to touch anything else, but doesn't actually tell her where she lives. Magwild appears to live inside a palace, and Viv touches her stuff, discovering that Magwild's mum attempted suicide. Her snipping is interrupted by Templar boys who break in for some reason, and she escapes through a, I kid you not, a secret passageway to a secret room filled with stuff about swords. Because mental. Later on, Magwild doesn't seem to give much of a shit that her flat was ransacked by nutters with swords, and Ben takes a while going through his databanks trying to work out what would be the best reaction he can give. He decides on a hug. Even a stopped clock is right twice a day. Back at the dig, they found out that Legas has bought the site.
Edward Legas has long held a belief that the country needs to restore the values and principles of the Knights Templar.
Of course he does, seeing as the Knights Templar's official crimes included pissing on the cross, raising the devil, and having anal sex on the altar. What right-wing fundamentalist Christian wouldn't want to return to their values? Unless he means their actual crimes, which included having a lot of power and money and killing brown people who worship the wrong god. Which, come to think of it, probably are the values he wants to return to.
Edward Legas announces plans to lobby Parliament for the abolishment of non-Christian religions in the UK.
Yeah, that's illegal according to European law. Legas, or more likely the writer, doesn't know anything about, well, anything. The guy wrote about a spaceship powered by love! They find a video where Legas bitches about foreign religions coming from the East coming into the country, ignoring the fact that that's how Christianity came to the UK in the first place, and that Islam is only a few hundred miles more eastern than Christianity. Templar boy is sharpening his sword in full view of the path when the Muslim guy he threatened comes to visit him. Without cops.
Don't make me go to the police. Stand down from this. You know, I don't want there to be any trouble.
Here we are, born to be kings. We're the princes of the universe.
Dumbass deserved that. When you're threatened by a lunatic religious fundamentalist with a sword, you do not go and have a secret meeting with him the next day. Seriously, this is basic survival tactics stuff. Legas comes to the dig site and wanders through the crowd like the slimy McSlimy head he is. The crowd are holding things like candles and doves, because Christians apparently can be spotted by holding candles and doves. Next time you see someone with a candle or a dove, it's Christian. So Legas intends on using the cross to rally the world to Christianity. Which makes no real sense, because if people wanted evidence that the founder of religion was real before they joined up, then why aren't everyone Muslims, Mormons, Baha'is, Sikhs, or Scientologists? And why not Raelians? Their founder Rael not only existed, but is still alive and wandering around in his silver moon boots and bedding hot Korean woman today.
Legas is going to twist all this into some kind of modern-day crusade.
So? So what? What's he going to do? Hey Muslims! Jesus existed! Yes, he's one of our prophets. We already believe he existed. No, he really existed! Great. Wonderful. His existence affronts your stupid god. No, our god is the father of Jesus, just like yours. You really aren't understanding this whole get pissed off thing, are you? No, not right now. What if I name this teddy bear Muhammad and then draw this teddy bear as a pig and then put this picture on the internet? Then you die!
Yes, it's war.
So Meg Wilde's worked out that the cross isn't actually buried there because there's a monk who watched the attack and wrote about it after the fact and sends Dr. Parton down to the library to find his writings so they can work out where the cross is or something. Dr. Parton is stalked by a Templar boy who was defeated by having a book shoved into his face and then is outrun by a man who was earlier described as Google with a beer gut. Parton reveals that the monk wrote that the Saracens who attacked them weren't actually Saracens, but the real explanation is only marginally less stupid. They were English mercenaries dressed to look like Saracens, because if you want to blend into the local areas before you kill people, a good way to do it is to dress like that country's mortal enemies who live 2,000 miles away and could not possibly have got over there. It's like trying to hide while assassinating an American politician by dressing like Osama bin Laden. It's retarded. So why did they leave Saracen coins? I can only assume that they killed the knights near the city so the bodies would be found and therefore make people think the Saracens did it, thus proving that the people who live nearby are dumbasses for not finding the bodies. Anyway, why did they dress up as Saracens? It'd just make their travel through England difficult. And where did they find the gear? Importing it's out of the question. And why did they dress like that if they were going to kill everyone? Just kill them and leave the coins and the scimitar and the people will assume that the Saracens killed them. Ah, but maybe they wanted a witness, and that's why they left the monk alive. If that's the case, why did they reveal they were English mercenaries while he was nearby? This is a Gordian knot of stupid. So eventually they work out that a snake and a sword on the back of the crucifix found with the dead knights is actually a map to where the true cross is. Seriously. The monk carved it onto the cross and left it with the dead knights, apparently in the knowledge that 700 years later, three idiots and one occasional part-time genius would find it and use it to find the true cross. Unfortunately, they leave the crucifix in their lab, and Templar boys and Slimy McSlimyhead can also read maps made of carvings of a snake and a sword, and follow them. So they find a church, but the cross isn't there, and they meet a walking plot device who, for no reason at all, offers to show them the dovecot in his garden, which of course was built at the same time as the church and happens to have never been excavated or renovated, and has a massive secret chamber below it. They should have just found this guy at the start of the episode. He could explain everything without all this shit. So like all archaeologists, they have a fuckload of climbing equipment randomly in the back of their van, for some reason, and they get unlocking this chamber of secrets. And what I wouldn't give for a basilisk to come out and kill everyone. So they climb down and discover that there's lots of crosses. Now, you'd expect the monk to have put a lot of fake crosses there to confuse anyone who tried to take the true cross. But no, they're all Roman crosses made at the time of Christ, and the Templars brought them all there because they didn't know which one was real. Of course, this doesn't explain why they were still carrying a piece of one on their way back when they were attacked by the fake Saracens. So the Templar boys have turned up still wearing their conspicuous outfits and using their broadswords, even though the local area is going crazy because of the beheading of the Muslim. Slimy McSlimyhead arrives and reveals that he not only believes that Christianity is native to the UK, but so are pure white doves. I really shouldn't complain. Several high members of the government of Northern Ireland believe that the British are the lost tribe of Israel. I'm not kidding. Fucking Northern Ireland. So Meg Wilde does what anyone else would do while surrounded by ancient, dry and precious wood. She lights a branch as a torch, just as Slimy McSlimyhead is lowered into the CGI chamber. He wonders what cross to take.
You are going to help me secure a cross. You will help me, or I swear to God this child will die.
So Meg Wilde sets fire to the crosses, destroying a lot of precious artifacts, and is raised high into the air by Ben. Viv runs off and narrowly avoids getting set on fire by the sudden conflagration. Slimy McSlimyhead waves around a broadsword that he somehow managed to hide in his suit, and one of the Templar boys complains that he doesn't have his friend's strength. Ben guesses that this means that the other one has killed someone, because Ben has psychic powers. So the Templar boy who killed the Muslim lowers himself down on a rope that's not actually being held by anyone, and tries to kill Magweld as they swing high above the fire. Why he doesn't stop aiming for her and instead aim at the rope that is holding her can best be explained with stupid. Ben manages to get through to the other Templar by telling him that Slimyhead's crusade isn't about faith, but power, which is bollocks because there are a myriad ways that a stupidly rich amoral bastard can get power that are much easier than setting off a holy war, finding the true cross, and raising a private army of swordsmen. So the other Templar boy's sense of logic is completely broken because Ben manages to get through to him. He cuts his best friend's rope, sending him falling to the floor. Viv manages to distract Slimyhead by singing at him, and Magwild kicks him into the cross, where he immediately burns like a scarecrow covered in petrol.
He chose poorly.
fallen Templar boy sees a vision of a knight and then gets set on fire. Now we've just seen severe damage to a farmer's property, someone destroy a lot of priceless artifacts, and seen two admittedly nasty men killed. A third man's entire life is in ruins, he had to kill his only friend and took part in the destruction of the cross he reveres. So how do we end the episode on a properly somber note?
Please, for the love of Jehovah, may we go to the pub.
Well, that was episode 1. It doesn't deserve a market of 10. That was Bonekickers. You were warned.
I shall do nothing to help you.
Someone help us!
There's some powerful people who do not want a black man for president.
Who's they?
It's a cover-up.
Brazos.
Everything comes to he who fights.
You're not in America now. I want to know who and why.
Does anybody else have an underpants situation?